to Lingthusiasm, a podcast that's enthusiastic about linguistics. I'm Gretchen McCulloch.
And I'm Lauren Gawne, and today we're getting enthusiastic about borrowing words between languages. But first, the 2022 Lingcom grant winners have been announced.
Yes, you can go to lingcom.org/grants to see this year's grant program. Thank you to everyone who applied, people who contributed to there being more grants. There were so many great applications, and we're really excited to see what happens with all the projects that people make.
This year we gave out $500 Lingcom grants, but we also gave out a whole heap of $100 startup grants. So there are even more potentially new and exciting Lingcom projects coming your way that you can check out at lingcom.org/grants.
This month's bonus episode is a sweary Q&A session that we did as part of our virtual live show about swearing in various languages. It was so great to hear everybody's contributions of different languages that you have learned swear words in.
You can get access to this plus our entire archive of bonus episodes by becoming a patron at patreon.com/lingthusiasm. Gretchen, I have a list of words for you, and it's your job to figure out what they all have in common.
Okay, great.
Chai.
Mm-hmm.
Croissant.
Okay.
Tea.
This is a great list.
Fur. Beef. Gymnasium. Pendle Hill.
Okay. So at first I was thinking this is a very delicious list. You know, you have chai, croissant, you know, I'm having a nice tea party. Beef, you know, maybe not tea party food, but delicious food. And then you said gymnasium.
Yes.
And Pendle Hill.
A place in the UK.
Which is a place in the UK. Okay, great. It's not like the name for some sort of biscuit that I don't know about.
Not that I'm aware of.
So, clearly we're not just dealing with the meanings of these words, because I guess they're all nouns, but that's kind of boring. So, I think I'm going to say what they all have in common is that they're all words that have gotten borrowed into English at some point.
That is correct.
Yay!
Borrowing words from other languages, and in this list, they come from a whole range of different languages, is something any language can do. English has a reputation for being very good at borrowing words from other languages, but it is a really common strategy for when you have to refer to something that you don't quite have a word for yet.
It's hard to even imagine English without loanwords. I mean, English without tea or something like this, because some of the loanwords in English are incredibly old and we've even forgotten that they're loanwords, mm-hmm. and some of them are very new and recent and in the process of being borrowed.
And it's not really borrowing, even though that is the term that gets used for it, because once we took tea as a word and as a beverage, like, we didn't ever give it back to the languages that these words were originally from.
Right, but also that didn't mean that the languages the words originally from had to stop using them in the way that if I borrow a book from you, like, you can't read that book until I give it back.
Yeah.
So I guess you could think of it as sort of more like the internet style, like, copy-pasting.
Okay.
You know, I copy-paste a word, like, the word still exists on your website, even though I've copy-pasted it and put it in mine. Or, like, you screen cap the word.
I like the screen capping idea of, like, borrowing words as internet memes that get circulated, because the more you kind of copy something and screenshot it and play around with it, there's all this glitchiness that happens in an image, and there's all this, like, small distortions that happen in a word when you borrow it as well.
Yeah, it sort of gets pixelated and watermarked around the edges, and I feel like that's something that sort of happens to words when they get passed around.
I mean, one of the things that's really immediately obvious is that a word often shifts its pronunciation a bit to fit into the way that the language that it arrives in is spoken.
Yeah, absolutely. I see this a lot with, there's so many words in English that have arrived from French, mm-hmm. both in ancient history periods and all the way up through the modern day. And there's so many different ways that they get pronounced depending on whether English speakers perceive them as still actively a French word or not.
Yeah. And there are some words where there's variation between speakers. So I say croissant with the final T, but I don't think you have that when you say that word.
No, I would say croissant. Like, I don't think of there as being a T there, even though, like, I'm not pronouncing it like it's fully French. Like, I'm not using the French R, croissant, which I would do if I was, like, in a bakery in Montreal.
Mm-hmm.
But I just don't think of the T as being pronounced there at all. And I noticed when you were reading the list of words that you pronounced the name of the Vietnamese noodle soup dish as pho, which is also how I would say it now. But when I first encountered this word, I pronounced it pho because I didn't know anything about the pronunciation of Vietnamese.
yeah, I remember when I learnt that the Vietnamese vowel that's used for pho is slightly different and definitely not what you would read if you were reading that directly as an English word. And I love getting to update my knowledge of how to pronounce words. I got to learn something about Vietnamese that I didn't know at that time.
But I expect neither of us are still pronouncing that word like exactly how it's said in Vietnamese, because we're still just doing an English approximation of it.
And Vietnamese is a language with tones, and I definitely don't know what tone that would be. It's kind of a midpoint in pronunciation that's closer to the original Vietnamese word. And part of that is that there is some of the orthography in Vietnamese that's not normally carried over into English. And part of the glitchiness of copy-pasting a word over from one language to another is that sometimes it needs to be copied into a new orthography as well as a new writing system. And that can change things up as well.
Right. And there are some things that are sort of easier to copy over. You know, if not pronouncing a T is sort of free, everyone knows how to not pronounce a T. But, you know, producing that sort of French R or the nasal vowel in croissant, like producing the tone in Vietnamese, is something that is not present in English. And so depending on what other languages you've been exposed to, certain types of pronunciation things can sort of come with it or not come with it.
Of course, there are always complications and exceptions. Japanese has a writing system that deals specifically with words of foreign origin, the katakana syllabary. But there are some words that have been borrowed for so long that they have their own kanji. They are more fully included in the writing system that Japanese has for its own vocabulary. So a word like tobacco, which was brought into Japan along with the leafy product in the 16th century, has its own kanji, which means that it is much less immediately recognizable as a loan word than something that is much more modern.
Ah, tabako. That sounds like it already sort of fits the sounds of Japanese and the syllable structure of Japanese, so it wouldn't seem as obviously foreign as a word that was pronounced very differently.
Yeah.
I think one of the classic examples with how writing systems sometimes influence how words get borrowed is, so in Chinese, there's a whole bunch of Chinese characters that have both a sound part and a meaning part to their to their shape. And there's a small set of them, about 200, that are used to convey spellings of words that are borrowed in from other languages. But their meaning is still transparent. If you're a Chinese speaker, you still recognize what that meaning is. You just also realize from context that it's being used to represent a foreign word. And so when Coca-Cola was first becoming available in Chinese, Coca-Cola, the company, hadn't yet made like an official transliteration available to shopkeepers. And so various shopkeepers came up with their own sort of ad hoc transliterations using these 200 characters that I used for foreign words.
I'm a little bit alarmed by various and ad hoc in that sentence there.
As well you should be, because some of these versions that people came up with, so the word la, I'm sure I'm doing the tone wrong, corresponds to the character for wax. And so a lot of them have to do with wax, to make sounds like Coca-Cola, such as female horse fastened with wax.
Mmm, delicious.
Wax flattened mare. Or bite the wax tadpole.
Right. I can see why you probably don't want to leave the transcription of your loan word in the hands of an ad hoc committee of shopkeepers.
Right. And so, you know, Coca-Cola, the company, did end up coming up with their own transliteration, actually using Coca-Cola, because they couldn't find a good la word that had a meaning that they wanted to associate with their product.
And what did that come out as?
So that came out as Coca-Cola, meaning to allow the mouth to be able to rejoice.
Oh, definitely more satisfying from a marketing perspective than wax flattened mare.
Yeah, exactly. So there's sort of ways that you deal with pronunciation and sort of approximating pronunciation and also giving people the ability to write or sort of transfer formats from one thing to another.
I guess we can think of fingerspelling in signed languages as a kind of loan word technique. So for, well, the signed languages I'm familiar with, including Auslan and ASL, there is a sign that represents each of the 26 letters of the English alphabet. And so if you need to tell someone, say, a person's name and they don't have a sign for their name in the language, you can spell out their name or you can spell out a technical term if you just need to kind of refer quickly to that. And the rate at which people fingerspell is phenomenal, whether it's the one-handed ASL system or the two-handed BSL Auslan system. But sometimes the fingerspelling becomes the name of the word. There are a few examples I know the Auslan for ham is literally just the letters H-A-M.
There you go.
So it's kind of a loan word there.
I sometimes see this when I'm looking at interpreters at conferences, and the speaker will say some sort of technical term, and then I'll see the interpreter, you know, a couple seconds later, like clearly spelling out something. And then sometimes they'll be in a bit of dialogue with the deaf person sitting in the front row, and the deaf person will tell them, oh, you mean this term. And then they'll start using something that's the actual sign for the technical term if they don't know what that is in ASL or different sign language.
Yeah, I think it turns up a lot in interpreting because you're often moving between a word in English and either agreeing upon a sign or finding some kind of commonality there. But it's not a strategy that has to be used in the language. Most words have their own sign. So it is kind of cute and funny when a word like ham pops up.
Yeah, it's sort of a way of bridging between these two modalities.
Hmm.
One of my favorite examples of something that happens when a word gets sort of brought over from one language to another is that sometimes the meaning can shift a bit while that's happening.
Another little glitch in the copy-paste.
Exactly. And I encounter this a lot in French because I encounter French so much. And recently I encountered the word séance, which in English would be séance.
Séance and like a thing where you try and speak to the dead.
Yeah. But in French, séance can also just be used as sort of a less formal version of a session.
Okay. That means it must pop up in a far broader range of contexts than speaking to the dead.
Right. So you can have something like a therapy seance or a workout seance, and that just means like a session.
And nothing paranormal, just to be really clear.
No paranormal people at the gym or not with your paranormal therapist.
So we've borrowed it into English with a really narrow meaning, but it has this much broader meaning in French.
Exactly. And the same thing goes amazingly with the word baguette, which, again, I imagine most people are probably familiar with as the kind of long bread.
Long loaf of bread.
Yeah, but baguette is actually a French word for a long, thin object.
Oh, so this explains why long-cut gems and diamonds and emeralds are called baguette cut.
Ah, I guess it does.
And I always thought that they were named after the loaf of bread, but it is, in fact, that it's a more general term in French. This makes so much more sense now.
Yeah, and also this explains why a friend of mine who was doing a French exam where you have like a reading passage, reading comprehension.
Mm-hmm.
And they had in this passage a baguette magique, which is not a magic baguette.
I feel disappointed already.
But in fact, a magic wand.
Ah, that makes a lot of sense.
Yes.
But is less whimsical.
And also a baguette chinoise. So these are chopsticks.
Ah, the long Chinese things.
Yeah, which, you know, coincidentally have to do with food, but are not involved, like, using a piece of bread to scoop up some food. It involves, you know, using chopsticks.
A much, much broader sense of the word baguette in the original language, borrowed for a specific thing into English.
Right, exactly. And you can kind of understand why, you know, this French kind of long bread is a very salient use of baguette, but is not the only kind.
Mm-hmm.
And it sort of gets us into what comes up a lot in language classes, the notion of false friends, of words that seem like they should directly translate from one language to another, but actually have different and sometimes embarrassingly different meanings.
Mm-hmm. Let's go with a couple of our favorites, just because they are so good.
There are so many. But, you know, speaking of embarrassing, English embarrassed and Spanish embarazada, which you might think might mean embarrassed.
Yes.
But in fact means pregnant.
Oh, yes. Very different. Yeah. She is embarrassed. One of my favorites is from our list at the top of the show, English gymnasium, as a place where you do physical activity and work out, is not to be confused with German gymnasium, which is a school. But even though they have different meanings, they do share a history because a Greek gymnasium was where you would learn and work out all together in an integrated system. And German took one part of that meaning and English took the other part. But you want to be really sure whether you're walking into a place of learning or working out.
Yeah, I think the equipment that you'd bring with you would be very different depending on which one you're aiming to do.
Mm-hmm.
The one that always gets me, and this is sort of a very Canadian experience of learning vocabulary from packaging, is that you can get toothpaste that's labeled pour les dents sensibles, which is for what looks like sensible teeth.
Mm-hmm. Your sensible toothpaste.
But in fact, it is for sensitive teeth, because sensible and sensible have different meanings, even though they look the same.
All of these examples are really great reminders that you can't just eyeball a loan word and take it for granted, because it's not always quite that simple.
sometimes you get a word that looks like a loan word, like it looks like it comes from another language, mm-hmm. but it doesn't actually exist in the other language with that meaning, or sometimes with any meaning at all.
Okay.
So there's this great French word, le babyfoot.
As in like the foot of an infant.
Yes, but it's all one word, babyfoot.
Okay. What does it mean? Because it sounds adorable.
It refers to the game that's found in pubs sometimes, where you have like a football game that you can play on a table.
Ah, yes.
Where you like twiddle the little knobs, which in English is known as foosball.
Yes.
But that's actually borrowed from German Fußball, which refers to just football in general.
Ah, we just call it German football.
Yeah.
Wow, that is definitely a borrowing that had a shift.
So it's a sort of double shift where, like, the French one is supposed to be English, but the English one is trying to be German. And the German word for this game is kicker, which is also looks like it's trying to be English.
Amazing.
So everyone's like, yeah, it's a great game. It has something to do with foot, but it's not a word in our language.
Because the linguist in me always is picking up on what people are saying, I found it really interesting that especially when you put the in front of it, your pronunciation of baby foot changed a little bit from how you say it in English, and you had kind of moved it into a slightly more French pronunciation.
Yeah, I think it's something interesting that I think about a lot when it comes to borrowing a word or using a loan word, mm-hmm. that how much are you using the sort of target language's pronunciation? If I'm borrowing something into English, do I pronounce it in an English way? Or how much are you using the source language's pronunciation? And how this sort of varies depending on, like, your level of knowledge of both of those languages, and also, like, who you're talking to and how much of those languages they know, and even sort of what you're trying to prove. Is this something you've experienced?
Yeah, I think about this a lot when I'm moving between Australia and Nepal, and when I choose to use particular words and how I pronounce them. So a word like chia, which is the Nepali word for tea, and particularly mm-hmm. the very sweet, strong tea that is brewed in Nepal. When I'm speaking to a Nepali in Nepal, in the language, I will say chia. But if I'm speaking to Australians there, I might say, do you want chai? Because that's the word they're more familiar with for that drink.
And if you go back to Australia and you're in like a coffee shop and you're like, oh, can I get a chai latte or something?
I would never try and order chia unless I'm with people who are going to make it properly.
There's this sort of like much parodied tendency for like North Americans to go on a trip to Barcelona and come back saying Barcelona or something like that and have learned zero other words of Spanish or Catalan at the time. But like now they're correcting everyone's pronunciation of the city and you're like, I don't know.
We have an exemplary sketch of this that we'll link to in the show notes where one of the characters in the sketch continuously from all of the languages that they are borrowing words from will use a very over-the-top pronunciation.
Yeah, and it's interesting because there are absolutely contexts in which pronouncing a word the way people are saying it around you is the polite thing to do. Mm-hmm. And there are also contexts in which pronouncing a word the way it's pronounced in the origin language, especially when it's been something that's borrowed in English for a long time, is kind of over-the-top and seems like you're over-exoticizing a word or sort of pretentiously talking down to somebody else because they are saying bruschetta or something like that. It's this interesting balance. I don't think there's just one answer.
I think there are certainly factors that you can take into account when you're making a decision about how to pronounce a word and that we all do take into account subconsciously. So what language are you speaking in? And who are you speaking to and where are you are all great things to keep in mind when you're making a choice about the pronunciation of a word like croissant. And for me, even though I'm not a very good French speaker, I will try and say it more francophone if I'm in a French speaking country.
Yeah, and I think being sensitive to some of the power dynamics around that, and there isn't just one answer for all of these circumstances. But sometimes these power dynamics, like how you pick which pronunciation to use in which circumstances, also show up in terms of which words get borrowed in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
I think the classic example in English is how we have a word for cow, which refers to the animal, and beef, which refers to the meat of that animal. The same thing with pig and pork, or sheep and mutton, although not as many people talk about mutton these days, or maybe chicken and poultry. And we have certain types of doublets of this in English, and cow and pig and sheep all come from Old English, where beef and pork and mutton come from Norman French because of this idea that sort of the English-speaking peasants were out in the fields, you know, farming with the cows and the pigs, and the Norman overlords were sitting there with their nicely sliced meat that was already prepared for them. And so the French word came to be used for the prepared or the dead thing. Whereas in French, you can have a mouton or a bœuf or something that refers to both the animal and the meat, the same way we do for chicken.
We also see this play out in terms of which languages we borrow scientific or technical vocabulary from. A lot of the vocabulary that we have in English for these fields comes from Latin and it comes from Greek. In fact, when we were preparing the show, Gretchen, you told me that tungsten is actually a Swedish word.
Yeah.
And I got completely surprised because I just assumed that it, like many of the other words for elements, had a Latin or a Greek origin.
Yeah, I came across this tweet saying that tungsten is literally from heavy stone in Swedish, which you can kind of see that sten meaning stone part. But the element is actually called wolfram, or probably volfram in Swedish.
Oh, so we didn't even borrow their name for the element from them. We borrowed the word heavy stone.
Yeah, it just sort of shifted again. This is something that I came across a lot when I was learning about constellations, because a lot of constellation names that we use for groups of stars still come from Greek mythology, even though many cultures have had names for groups of stars in their ontologies, but the ones that the scientific community has inherited have been largely from Greek. Mm-hmm. But the names of specific stars largely come from Arabic.
Huh.
And I feel like this reflects maybe some differences in sort of priorities about, are you going to name the specific stars or are you going to name the groups of stars, that these two cultures that came in contact with each other. And now, like, scientists have this sort of hybrid system where it's like some parts Greek, some parts Arabic.
One of the things I always find interesting about these loan words that come to us in kind of batches from particular domains is how it highlights global history, and usually like global histories of trade and different power dynamics that have operated over that history. One of my absolute favorite stories is the story of tea. We've already talked about chai and chia in Nepali, tea in English. The words for tea in many of the world's languages appear to be related. They'll either have some kind of te or tea pronunciation or some kind of chia, chai pronunciation. And that's because there were two main places in China from which tea traveled to all the different markets in the world.
Yeah, so in Mandarin, which is historically more spoken towards the center of China, the word for tea is cha. But in Minnan, which is also a variety of Chinese, spoken in the coastal province of Fujian, it's pronounced te. They use the same character, but they're pronounced differently, which is very common for how Chinese gets written. And the key thing here is coastal, because people who encountered the plant and the drink tea via the sea, via Fujianese traders, learn to pronounce it te, or variants on te. You know, in French and German, it's te. In English, it sort of used to be te until the vowels shifted. Whereas people who encountered tea through central China, through land routes like the Silk Road, so through Sinitic cha, you get Mandarin cha, Korean cha, Japanese ocha, but also Hindi chai, Persian chai, Arabic chai, Turkish chai, Russian chai, and down to Swahili chai, all goes, you know, through that land route and sometimes via Persian to get from cha to chai. The great maps that people have produced where you can tell if people encountered tea through the land route where they get cha, which becomes chai, or through the sea route, which becomes te and variants on te like tea.
And then there are a small number of languages like Polish, where the word for tea is herbata, which is a borrowing from the Latinate word that we have in our language as herb.
Yeah, and in places where tea leaves were already indigenous and they weren't encountering them via trade, like in Burmese, for example, tea leaves are lakpak, I hope I'm saying that right, because they didn't need to use a trade word for something they already had.
One of the other global stories I love is the transfusion of the technology and the terminology for books out from Arabic into a large sphere of the world.
Yeah, so kitab is the Arabic word for book, but words that are related to kitab show up in a whole bunch of languages around the world. Persian, Hindi, I think Nepali, right? Azerbaijani, Kazakh. So sort of in that area of Asia, but also Swahili. In Kinyarwanda, the word is igitabo, which sounds like kitab, but you've put more vowels in it. And then the plural is ivitabo, because the ki becomes be, basically, to make it plural, which is a systematic thing that happens in a whole bunch of words. And they were like, ah, a singular word that begins with ki, we know what to do with this. And sort of adapted that to the local way of forming words as well. So it's this great example of how you borrow when you need to fill a gap in your vocabulary. You know, a lot of languages have borrowed the English word for computer because computer is spread through English. And then whenever I see kitab show up in another language that I'm encountering, I'm like, ah, yes, I know where you got that one.
And that was a really nice example of how when a word gets borrowed, often it will be kind of regularized into the language. So kitab, the plural in Arabic, is kutub.
Mm-hmm.
But in Kinyarwanda, it's regularized into the plural system there. And in languages like Nepali, it's kitab in the singular and kitabharu in the plural. They've used their standard plural form there as well. So part of the kind of borrowing it in and making it part of your own vocabulary is making it part of the grammatical system.
And sometimes this happens through reanalyzing part of the word to do something else. Sometimes you can just add another thing like haru to make it plural.
Mm-hmm.
I almost feel like English was kind of missing out because we didn't get to be part of the kitab party.
Yeah.
But if we borrowed it, it would probably turn into kitabs because like that's how we make plurals. But when English borrowed the word for cherry from French, We borrowed it as cherries, which is modern French cerise. And then people reinterpreted that S as if it was already plural and backformed the word cherry as the singular of that.
Okay, so the French cherries, that's actually the singular. That just means one.
Yeah.
One cherries.
Yeah.
Okay. There we go. As an English speaker, my brain just hears that sir and thinks we're talking more than one.
Exactly. Like the more sort of deeply intertwined a language's borrowing can happen with the stuff that's already going on in the language, I think the more fun it is.
Mm-hmm.
One of my favorite examples of this is the word for download, which, like a lot of computer vocabulary, has been borrowed from English into a lot of languages.
Mm-hmm.
The word for download in German is download. But if you make it past, you can get things like downgeloadet. Because I have downloaded, the way you can form that is by putting the g and the et at the end.
So it behaves exactly like a regular German verb would in that context.
Right, but it's separating out the down and the load because German is sort of close enough to English that they're like, oh yeah, mm-hmm. we can recognize that these are two parts and we're going to put the g in the middle, which you wouldn't do if it was something you were borrowing and you didn't have any context for. It's a sort of interesting reanalysis.
And then English has borrowed so many words from languages like Latin and Greek, usually via French, that we now have just borrowed the affixes that they use. So ation in mm-hmm. English, like motivation and meditation, they were Latin words with their Latin affixes. But now I can use a suffix like ation, or eyes is another one from Greek. I could say I can chai eyes my cake.
Putting chai in it, yeah.
Not the most elegant example of that, but it's now become something useful in English because we borrowed so many words with these affixes.
The other thing that I find really fun when, again, watching languages intertwine via borrowing is when the concept behind the word gets borrowed, but not the actual word itself. They translate it sort of piece by piece. I first encountered this when I was learning German in high school, and I learned the German word fernseher, which means television.
Okay.
But it literally translates as farseer. Fernseher is farseer.
Hang on, wait a minute. That's also what television means.
Yeah, it sure is. So tele is Greek for distance, mm-hmm. and vision, of course, is seeing. So somebody went and said, oh, what's the name for this technology? Ah, they're using these Greek and Latin roots. What if we use Germanic roots for this concept?
And you get the farseer.
Yeah.
Another really great example of this is English skyscraper.
Mm.
Because those two parts, sky and scraper, get literally translated across a range of languages.
Oh yeah, because in French it's gratte-ciel, which is literally like scrape sky.
Yeah, Italian is gratte-ciel and German is Wolkenkratzer. And they all literally mean scraped sky.
Yeah, there's a whole bunch of examples from various languages that have been like, what a great mental image. But actually, we're going to translate like each of these words individually.
Mm-hmm.
There are also sometimes people do sort of experiments with trying to undo loanwords. There's a paper called Uncleftish Beholding,
mm-hmm.
which is written in English, trying to explain atomic theory in only words with English etymologies.
Okay, so ignoring the last 1,000 years of contact that English has had with an incredible variety of other languages.
Right, exactly. So uncleftish, like an atom is literally something that's not split in its Greek roots.
Mm-hmm.
So if you have uncleft, that is literally translating sort of piece by piece this idea of atomic, uncleftish, and then you can sort of keep going. like translating water stuff for hydrogen, because like hydro just means water.
Amazing, but I imagine quite a bit of mental gymnastics to read.
Yeah, it's definitely a sort of interesting thought experiment to read, but, you know, hasn't caught on.
The technical term for this translation, instead of just borrowing the word, but translating it literally into the other language, is called calquing, which I find very satisfying because calque is a loanword from French, but loanword is a calque of the German word that we got the concept from in the first place.
Yeah, so it's like calque is a loanword, but loanword is a calque, and you could have really just done this the other way around and it would have been pleasantly symmetrical, but also no.
It would have been wonderfully self-defining, but here we are.
I also find it really interesting when languages borrow other grammatical features from each other that may be a little bit more abstract than an individual word.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a really interesting paper by the linguist Marianne Methune, who wrote a paper about sort of this question of why there are certain areas of the world that tend to have certain grammatical types of features, even when the languages that have a particular grammatical feature aren't necessarily historically related to each other, as in coming from a common ancestor.
Okay, so if they're not all getting it from a common ancestor, what is happening?
Right, exactly. So if you take something like evidentiality, one of your favorite features.
Indeed.
Where you indicate the source of the information that you got something, whether you experienced it with your own senses, whether you heard it from someone else. And this is the kind of feature that I know when linguists learn about it, like when I learned about it in grad school, I spent like a couple of weeks being like, now I need to pay attention to like all of the sources for all the information that I had, like while I was speaking English, even though we don't have this as a grammatical type of thing. And so Marianne Methune's paper points out that if you have a whole region where a whole bunch of languages have evidentiality, even though historically evidentiality only comes from like one family that's not necessarily related to all of them, it might be because a lot of people have been bilingual and multilingual in this area for a long period of time. Because when one of your languages has evidentiality or something else, it might make you want to sort of use those optional ways of marking evidence in the other languages you speak as well.
Yeah, this definitely fits with what I've noticed in Yolmo. There is a evidential category for like something being a generally known fact. I get a lot of examples like lemons are sour, sugar is sweet. And this doesn't exist in any of the other Tibetan languages, but something very similar happens in the unrelated language next door.
Mm.
And there is a long history of women coming from those villages and marrying into the Yolmo area. And so our working theory is that they brought this evidential that they found useful in their own language in Tamang and brought it into Yolmo. And they have a calque, so it's the literal bits of the word in Tamang show up as the same literal bits of the word in Yolmo.
And especially that this seems to happen in communities with a lot of early multilingualism. So precisely this, when you have intermarriages where your parents speak different languages and the kid grows up speaking both from a very early age, it's not something that is a bit harder to learn as an adult to pay attention to all of this. It's like you're learning it really early. And so you're like, yeah, this is something that I'm used to paying attention to.
And these loanwords are so powerful that they've shifted parts of the grammar of Yolmo to make sure that the language accounts for them.
So we often talk about borrowing as like, okay, this word got borrowed from this language, but it's really part of a continuum with the larger history of how languages exist in contact with each other, and people often know multiple languages and use several languages flexibly. And so like when a borrowing is really recent, we just call it code switching. And when a borrowing is really old and people have sort of forgotten that it was borrowing, we just call it an etymology.
Absolutely.
And borrowing is somewhere that's sort of halfway in between.
Yeah. For sure. It's all very gradient and, as we've discussed a little bit so far, very context dependent. But to give a sense of how borrowings can be old enough that we even forget that we borrowed them in the first place, one really great example of this is a phenomenon of duplicating a word across languages.
Oh, I love this one.
So Pendle Hill at the top of the show was one of the loan words that I mentioned to you.
So does this mean Hill Hill?
Well, in the 13th century, it was called Pennel or Penhole, which was from the older Cumbric, which was the language that was in the area before English came in, pen. Pen means hill.
Okay.
And hull meant, in Old English, as it does now, hill.
Oh, no.
But they were kind of squashed together into Pennel or Pendle. And then people forgot that original hill and hill were there, and so it is now Pendle Hill.
So that's hill, hill, hill.
In a very literal translation, yes.
Amazing. I think there's also Brennan Hill elsewhere in Britain that is also from three words that mean hill all in a row. And you have Celtic word and words keep getting added.
There are so many examples of this because as people forget the original meaning, they keep adding the specifier. I'm going to let you share a few of your favorites.
One of my favorites, because it exposes some etymologies that are right there in plain sight, is the Mississippi River, which is from the Ojibwe Missi Zibi. So Zibi means river, and Missi means like great. So this is the Great River River.
The Great River River.
And you can see the same word meaning great show up in Lake Michigan.
Is the Mishi in Michigan and the Missi in Mississippi the same root?
Yeah.
Ah.
So those are both great, large. Guess what the Gan part means?
Great. Is it lake? Like Lake Michigan?
Yes. So we have not only Great River River, but also Lake Large Lake, because there was a French alternation that happened in between.
There are so many, especially when we borrow words into English where we're not familiar with the underlying etymology in the language they come from. So Mount Kilimanjaro in Tanzania is Mount Ninjaro in Swahili.
Oh, so Kilima is also Mount.
Mm-hmm.
Great. One that I learned recently is, so East Timor, the country East Timor, which is also known as Timor-Leste, is Timor also means east?
I guess that island just above Australia was named by some people living further west of them.
It sure was. And then East Timor itself is on the eastern half of the island of Timor, which is itself east of something. And the Leste part for the modern name Timor-Leste is from the Portuguese word for east, Leste.
Oh my gosh, that was sitting right in front of my face and I did not say that.
Yeah, so the Timor is from the Indonesian and Malay word Timor meaning east, and then there's several different versions of more east from European languages as well.
I think about this a lot when I'm back in Australia. I will order a chai tea in some contexts because I want to be very specific about what I'm ordering. And chai is not the default only tea option in Australia. So I will use duplicates like this occasionally.
I recently saw a TikTok video, someone pointing out that, like, you know, naan bread is a duplication of the same concept because naan just means bread. But also that the Hindi Urdu word for Western style sliced bread is pao roti, which comes from the Portuguese pão, meaning bread.
Oh.
So that's also bread.
That's also the same in Nepali, and I never knew where pao came from, and I would never have guessed Portuguese, but it's just bread.
It's bread. There are many kinds of bread.
It goes in both directions as well. We duplicate naan bread, and they duplicate pao roti.
Yeah, amazing. I think that the choice of whether to duplicate or not is a way of taking a particular linguistic stance.
Mm-hmm.
If you're adding the word that you're familiar with to it, then it's a way of saying, okay, this is a particular type, which is not my default type. And if you're sort of refusing to add that additional word, it's a way of saying, no, this is my default type, or this is something that is more central to me, and I don't feel like I need to explain it. But I mean, there are a lot of words in the world, and there are a lot of languages in the world, and everything is new to somebody at some point.
I think it's a really great reminder that when it comes to loanwords, there isn't one simple answer about how they get integrated, but they are so pervasive. So if you have your own stories about loanwords, experiences of shifting between languages and using loanwords, we would love to hear them on the Lingthusiasm Discord or on other social media. For more Lingthusiasm and links to all the things mentioned in this episode, go to lingthusiasm.com. You can listen to us on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, SoundCloud, YouTube, or wherever else you get your podcasts, and you can follow at Lingthusiasm on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and Tumblr. You can get IPA scarves, glottal bottles, and other Lingthusiasm merch at lingthusiasm.com/merch. I tweet and vlog as Superlinguo.
I can be found as at Gretchen A. McSee on Twitter. My blog is allthingslinguistic.com. My book about internet language is called Because Internet. Have you listened to all the Lingthusiasm episodes and you wish there were more? You can get access to an extra Lingthusiasm episode to listen to every month, plus our entire archive of bonus episodes to listen to right now at patreon.com/lingthusiasm or follow the links from our website. Have you gotten really into linguistics and you wish you had more people to talk with about it? Patrons can also get access to our Discord chat room to talk with other linguistics fans. Plus, all patrons help keep the show ad-free. Recent bonus topics include a live show Q&A about swearing, how linguists pick a research topic, and a chat with Nicole Holliday and Ben Zimmer from Spectacular Vernacular. Can't afford to pledge? That's okay too. We also really appreciate it if you can recommend Lingthusiasm to anyone in your life who's curious about language.
Lingthusiasm is created and produced by Gretchen McCulloch and Lauren Gawne. Our senior producer is Claire Gawne. Our editorial producer is Sarah Doppiarella. Our production assistant is Martha Tsutsui Billens. And our production manager is Liz McCullough. Our music is Ancient City by The Triangles.
Stay Lingthusiastic!